And so I don't know where you come up with the idea that the only type of Christian music is stuff that just talks about the Lord.
Well, what is the definition of Christian? You know, there was a man in the CCM movement named...
No, the definition of Christian.
Yeah, what is the definition of Christian?
As far as what?
What's the definition of Christian?
Of who is a Christian?
What's the definition of the word? What's it mean?
It's a follower of Jesus Christ.
Ah, yes, Christ-like, absolutely. Now, can you plug Jesus Christ into a stage with bombs going, smoke blowing, hair teased up to the moon, in skin-tight spandex and leather, bouncing around with a bass guitar and rubbernecking while the crowd scream?
Can you put Jesus Christ into a place where he's sitting around with prostitutes and tax collectors?
Yes, and when Jesus Christ did that, he convicted them of their sins by his very presence. He never took part in their sins, and there's the difference. There's the line. Never cross over that line. That's blasphemy.
For 13 years, Jeff Godwin was a slave to rock music. After having his life totally transformed by Jesus Christ, God called him to the ministry of research, exposing the evils of rock and Christian rock. This video will help you understand Satan's influence in popular music. For a copy of this and other videos, books, and cassette tapes, please write us at The Rock Ministries, P.O. Box 2181, Bloomington, Indiana, 47402. Or call us at Logos Communication Consortium, 1-800-231-1605.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Jeff Godwin, and today we're going to be talking about Christian rock music and Christian contemporary music. Now, if anybody ever dares to even question whether Christian rock music is of God and matches the Word of God, there are many Christian rock fans that get very angry for some reason. And I just want to encourage you as you watch this entire video. If that's you, and if you find yourself getting angry at some of the things that are discussed and some of the things that are exposed, ask yourself a question. Why am I getting angry? James 1:20 says, "For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God." And if what we're talking about today makes you mad, and if music is just music, and it really isn't an idol or a god in your life, then you shouldn't get angry. The Bible is my standard of authority, and everyone who professes Christ as their Savior should say the same thing. So if you're a Christian, just as I am, then we should be able to stand on the Word of God and match anything we have questions about against the Word of God. James 4:4 says, "Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God." Romans 12:2 says, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." 1 John 2:15 and 16 says, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." The Bible teaches us very clearly that if something is of the world, then it's God's enemy. Now, either Christian rock is right or it's wrong by the Word of God. Either contemporary Christian music is right or it's wrong by the Word of God. Many Christian rock defenders will say, "But Jesus Christ moved among the world. He was in the world. He was around prostitutes and sinners." Yes, that's true. But Jesus Christ's presence convicted those people of their sins. He never crossed the line and actually took part in their sins. Hebrews 7, verse 26 says, "For such an high priest became us who is holy, blameless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens." Christian rock is either right or wrong. And I think by the time you're done seeing this video, you're going to know the truth about what's wrong with Christian rock. One of the main pillars of Christian rock is the idea that all music is neutral. There was a very famous CCM star named Keith Green, who's dead now, who first wrote in his famous tract, "Can God Use Rock Music?" that all music is neutral. And as long as the heart of the musician is sincere, And as long as the words in the song are godly, then it's a godly music. Is that true? Is music neutral? Music is a spiritual creation. The Bible bears this out very clearly. When David was playing his godly music for King Saul, who was obsessed and possessed by an evil spirit, that godly music made the evil spirit flee from Saul. It made Saul well and refreshed in his body and in his mind. Now, neutral music does not give positive results. Neutral music will not give negative results. If music is truly neutral, it won't give any results, and we wouldn't even be having a conversation like this because there would be no controversy about Christian rock. You see, music is a spiritual creation that is created in the spirit of the musician. It is channeled through the instrument he plays, and it goes right into the ears and the spirit of the person listening. Therefore, music is going to have a spirit about it, all music, and either that spirit is going to be the spirit of God, or it's going to be the spirit of Satan. Here's a picture of Keith Green, the first CCM star to say that all music is neutral. We're going to do a little experiment here. Ask yourself a question as we play the next two pieces of music for you. As you listen to number one and number two, ask yourself, is this music Christian or is this music secular, worldly? The answers may surprise you. Okay, you've heard both pieces of music now. It's time to find out which was Christian, which was secular or worldly. Here's number one. It's Twisted Sister. But wait a minute. The message in that song was real good, wasn't it? It was about looking into your heart and seeing that it's black and that you didn't want to burn in hell and you'd better make a decision about something before it's too late, right? So if the message is good, then the music has to be Christian, right? No. Here are the Christians, number two, Rez Band. Do you know what the moral of the story is? If you and I can't tell the difference between the world and the Christian by looking or by listening, then there is no difference. They're the same thing. And if you have an ungodly spirit in the world's music, and you can't tell the difference in what's passing for Christian rock, then it's the same ungodly spirit. Christian rock music and so-called contemporary Christian music is filled with blasphemy of the Lord Jesus Christ. You want some examples of this? There are many magazines, CCM magazines, that offer for sale various t-shirts. You're supposed to wear these t-shirts if you're a Christian, and then you're going to witness Christ on the front of your chest. Now, if you want to put a scripture verse on your shirt and witness Jesus, there's nothing wrong with that. But take a look at some of these pictures. Here's the first one. In the top row, you have a Spuds McKenzie-type dog licking up a pool of vomit. Now, I don't know about you, but if I saw somebody walking down the street with a t-shirt on that had a dog licking up a pool of vomit, the first thing I'm going to think is, hey, a Christian, right? Here's another example. In the top row, toward the right, there's a picture of Moses with sunglasses and a parasol having a little picnic on the shore of the Red Sea. And it's titled Red Sea Beach Club. This is blasphemy. This is abusing and making profane one of the greatest miracles in the Old Testament, the parting of the Red Sea. When the Israelites looked back and saw Pharaoh and his chariots coming to butcher every man, woman, and child, were they having a little picnic at the Red Sea? No. They were screaming and calling out to God for deliverance, and he did deliver his people. This isn't funny, it's not a joke. You and I should always be able and willing to laugh at ourselves, but we should never laugh at the things of the Bible, and we should never mock the things of God. That's wrong. And Christian rock says it's funny. The next example is a t-shirt that says, God wiser, this blood's for you. Now my question to every Christian watching this right now is, how much is the blood of Christ worth to you? Is it worth a can of Budweiser beer? You see, not only are these things in bad taste, but they mock and put Christ to an open shame, and that's wrong, and we shouldn't be supporting these kinds of things. Here's another example of blasphemy in Christian rock. This is a poster that CCM Magazine offered for sale called Jesus the Surfer. Now, Jesus Christ was not a surfer. Jesus Christ was a Jew. Jesus Christ is the Savior of mankind for all who will come to him and repent of their sins and ask him to come into their heart as their personal Savior and accept his sacrifice for them. Jesus Christ was not polishing a surfboard out in the ocean. He was dying for lost men and women, boys and girls. That's not funny. Christian rock also is full of witchcraft. Now, keep in mind that if you have an ungodly satanic spirit in music, it doesn't matter what the words say. The spirit's the same. Here's an example from Michael W. Smith's Big Picture album. Now, a lot of times Satan marks his stuff in the early stages, in the first runs, the first productions of videos and tapes and albums years ago when Big Picture came out. And that's just the case here. If you will look very closely at the writing at the top, you will see runic symbols. Now, what are the runes? There were missionaries who came into Europe centuries ago who introduced their own alphabet because the pagan tribes there were already using the runes. The runes have always been a witchcraft alphabet. They've been used to cast spells. You can even walk into occult bookshops today and other bookstores and buy runes in order to divine the future. So you see, Satan has marked this album by Michael W. Smith very plainly. And here's some proof of that from books about the runes. The M and the T in Michael and Smith are runic letters. Now, if you take this original album and you flip it over, you'll see Michael W. Smith's name has been written a certain way. How has it been written? It's backwards. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means plenty in the occult. Aleister Crowley, a master Satanist who died in 1947, encouraged his followers to walk backwards, talk backwards, think backwards, listen to phonograph records backwards, and write backwards. Reverse writing is a satanic principle. Am I saying that Michael W. Smith is a Satanist? No. I am saying that Satan always marks his stuff, and this record is no exception. You see, Michael W. Smith and other Christian rock performers may be very sincere in what they do. I'm not saying they're not sincere. I can't judge their heart. Only God can. But they can also be very sincerely wrong. And when you cross over into Satan's musical territory, as the Christian rock performers have done, then you open yourself up to a whole variety of demonic actions. And so somebody in the Michael W. Smith organization has marked his stuff. Of course, when the later runs of tapes, cassettes, and videos came out on many of them, Michael W. Smith was not written backwards, but Satan made his mark. Here's another example of witchcraft in Christian rock. This is the heavy metal Christian rock group Stryken. And at the top in the circles, you see the satanic lightning bolt S. Jesus Christ said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. And Satan has taken that lightning bolt and used it as his own sign and symbol. This also is a rune. It's called the Sig rune. It was used by the Nazis in World War II because under orders from Heinrich Himmler, excavations were dug throughout Bavaria and runic inscriptions were uncovered, and it was put into the Gestapo's uniforms. That's where it came from, and here it is on the cover of a Christian rock album. We're going to talk about more witchcraft in Christian rock, and one of the stars we're going to expose in this may surprise you. There's a very famous Christian rock performer who does the sign of allegiance to the devil in concert. We're going to take a look in a second at a video clip of her doing just that. You can find this sign on the back of the Satanic Bible by Anton LaVey. It doesn't mean I love you, it means allegiance to Satan. When the thumb and two middle fingers are turned down and the index and the pinky are turned up, it signifies the horns of the goat and that the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are in subjection to the devil and Antichrist. Here's the performer that does this sign. It's Amy Grant. We're going to look at some live footage now when Amy makes a guest appearance on Michael W. Smith's In Concert video. And we're going to take it frame by frame, and we're going to show you that Amy Grant is making not only the Cornuto sign, but she is also doing a Wiccan moon sign. Now, am I saying that Amy is a witch? Oh, no. I don't know Amy's heart. All I'm saying is that Amy Grant and the others, even though they may be very sincere, have been caught up in a spirit, and it is not the Spirit of God. And these things are showing themselves in their performances and in their advertising and in the products they produce. Watch very carefully now as we go frame by frame. Amy Grant does this sign not once, but twice in the video. Now, watch very, very carefully. First, Amy's hand is down. Now it's moving up slowly. And right here is the Wiccan moon sign of Wiccan witchcraft. And we'll show you proof of that. Next, her hand goes up slowly. The Wiccan sign disappears. And she's doing the Cornuto devil salute. Here's one more example of witchcraft and Satanism in contemporary Christian music. This is a picture of CCM star Steve Taylor. This is from the cover of one of his albums. Here's another photograph of Steve making the same sign with his hand. What does that mean? Where did it come from? Steve says that this sign language came from a poster that he saw in Vienna. Oh no, that sign comes straight from Satanism, and here's proof. It's the sign of the Baphomet, the goat of Mendes, worshipped by Satanists worldwide. Now, I'm not saying that Steve Taylor or any of these people are worshipers of the devil, but I am saying this. Satan is in control of Christian rock. Satan is in control of contemporary Christian music because all rock and roll is based on rebellion. And there is no such thing as good rebellion, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry, 1 Samuel 15:23. You know, many Christian rock fans and defenders will come to me and to my wife, and they'll say things like, John 7:24 says, judge not according to the appearance. But then they'll forget the other half of the verse that says, but judge righteous judgment. Christian rock fans and defenders will say, but Matthew 7:1 says, judge not that thou be not judged. And they'll forget the other verses that follow, which say, thou hypocrite, first cast the beam out of thine own eye, and then you will be able to see clearly to cast the mote out of thy brother's eye. You have to come out of these things before your mind is open to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let's take a look at what the Bible says about the outward appearance. This is not my opinion. This is what the Word of God says as we look at some famous stars of Christian rock. Proverbs 6, 16 and 17. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him, a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. Proverbs 21, 29, a wicked man hardeneth his face. Now take a very close look here as we slow down this famous video from Rez Band, one of the biggest stars in Christian rock. Take a look at Wendy Kaiser's face as we go frame by frame. A wicked man hardeneth his face. Can you honestly say that the fruits of the Holy Spirit, the love, the joy, the peace, the temperance, the meekness, the long-suffering, and all of those other things from Galatians 5 are present in this woman's face? Proverbs 21, verse 4, an high look and a proud heart and the plowing of the wicked is sin. Isaiah 3, 9, the show of their countenance doth witness against them, and they declare their sin as Sodom. They hide it not. Woe unto their soul, for they have rewarded evil unto themselves. Isaiah 38, 18, For the grave cannot praise thee, death cannot celebrate thee. They that go down into the pit cannot hope for thy truth. There is no hope on these faces. Now, if these people, the stars of Christian rock, have no hope, and it shows on their face, how in the world can they offer any hope to anybody else? Job 11, verse 20, but the eyes of the wicked shall fail, and they shall not escape, and their hope shall be as the giving up of the ghost. Obadiah 3, the pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock. Jeremiah 5, 3, thou hast consumed them, but they have refused to receive correction. They have made their faces harder than a rock. They have refused to return. That's what the Bible says about the outward appearance. What kind of Jesus is being produced through Christian rock? What kind of Jesus is being presented? Is it the true, holy Lord of lords and King of kings? Or is it some cardboard cutout Christ, manufactured for our desires, for our lusts? You know that the kind of Jesus that's coming through Christian rock and CCM today is a hippie buddy. He's your good friend. This first started with Jesus Christ Superstar many, many years ago. Jesus Christ is not a superstar. Jesus Christ is the Lord of glory and the Savior of mankind. And if you don't know him as your personal Savior, you need to. And the Bible says that to do that, you must repent of your sins. You must admit you're a sinner. You must believe in your heart. You must not be ashamed to confess with your mouth. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, Romans 10, 13. You have to break, your heart has to open, and you have to ask Christ to come in. That's the plan of salvation from the book of Romans, the book of Luke, chapter 13. Jesus Christ is not a superstar, but Christian rock says he is. There's a famous CCM star named Jeff Fenholt, who at one time played the part of Jesus on the Broadway production of Jesus Christ Superstar. We're going to take a look at an interview with Jeff Fenholt in Moscow.
So what do you think about rock music? Is that true?
Well, I think if the heart of the musician belongs to the devil, then the music belongs to the devil. My heart belongs to Jesus. So my music belongs to the Lord.
Jeff Fenholt just said that as long as his heart is sincere, then his music is anointed of God. Is that true? The Bible says in Jeremiah 17, 9 and 10 that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, will search the heart. I try the reins, even to give to every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. Just because our hearts are sincere doesn't mean we're doing the work of the Lord. Take a look here at Jeff Fenholt in concert, singing Jailhouse Rock by Elvis Presley to the Russians in English with different words. Then look at the reaction of those who are listening. These Russian fans are dancing because Jeff Fenholt is singing rock and roll. They can't even understand what he's singing. They're relating to sin. This is another one of the biggest lies in Christian rock today, that somehow through the music we're going to relate to people in a way that they can understand. But what is it they're relating to? They're relating to the same old sins. And the Bible never gives us the okay or the go-ahead to use sinful means to preach the gospel. What kind of Jesus Christ is coming through the evangelizing of Christian rock and CCM? This is supposed to be the greatest strength in Christian rock today, that they are evangelizing thousands and thousands of young people. Let's take a listen to the music of Bride and see what kind of a gospel message is coming through. How would you like to have those guys come play at your church next Sunday? You know, the sad thing is, there's many a church doing it. And the excuse is, if we don't get this music in the church, then the children won't come and they won't stay. But my encouragement to you, if you're in a position of leadership, pastors and youth leaders, if that's what you've got to do to get the kids through the door, then let them go, because they were never committed to Christ in the first place. And when the music stops playing, they won't stay. How are we to evangelize? We're to evangelize the same way it's always been done for the better part of 2,000 years. For it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And that's 1 Corinthians 1:21. Preaching, not music, is what gets people saved. What about all this evangelizing that's going on in Christian rock? Let's take a look at Milon Lefebvre. Let's take a look at one of Milon's videos called Trains Up in the Sky. The clip that you just saw from the famous Milon Lefebvre and Broken Heart video, Trains Up in the Sky, showed dancers around a voodoo campfire under the full moon, while Milon sits there with sunglasses on. What kind of a message is coming through here? What has this got to do with Jesus Christ? Do you know what the true message there is? It's the idea that rock and roll has always been about the worship of devils, and that's true. If you listened very closely to that first clip, you heard voodoo chants going on in the background. Now, if we go to the very end of that clip, you'll see Milon and his band in concert. Listen carefully once again in the background, behind the music, and you'll hear the same voodoo chant. And take a look at Milon's face. He is marked on his cheek with two stripes, as if he's some sort of voodoo high priest. Let's take a look at a video by Milon Lefebvre and his band Broken Heart called Sheep in Wolves Clothing. They're live in concert here. Let's take a look. If you listen closely to what Milon was singing, he was talking about being marked with the mark of the beast. But Milon and his band and all the other Christian rockers and rock stars out there don't understand that they already have been marked by the mark of the beast. You know, we're so busy waiting in Christianity for some laser tattoo or some type of microchip implant to come along to mark into people's skin, as the Bible says in Revelation 13, that we don't realize that the spiritual mark of the beast is already here. People are being marked in their foreheads in the way they think, and they're being marked in their right hands in the way they act, as a preparation to take that literal physical mark in the not-too-distant future. And Christian rock is one of the main ways Satan has implanted that mark into the minds of millions and millions of young people. He's raising an army for Antichrist, and he doesn't care if they profess that they're Christians or if they don't. It doesn't matter to the devil, because he will get worship any way he can. And that's just exactly what's going on in Milon's video. It's the worship of rock and roll, and the god of rock and roll is Satan. Let's take a look here at the 1991 Dove Awards, and we'll kind of Jesus is being presented and what kind of gospel message is coming through one of the biggest songs on that show. What you just saw was a man named Charlie Peacock. The song he played was called Big Man's Hat. It received all kinds of awards and was the premiere of the Dove Awards telecast. What was that song about? Was it about Jesus? No, it was about Charlie's old girlfriend from years ago. That's the kind of evangelization that's going on through Christian rock. Listen to Sandy Patty's comments at the Dove Awards about what CCM music is today.
Dolly Peacock! A remarkable young man who has struggled and found in the gospel real meaning for his music and his life.
What a strong message there is in Charlie's songs. I mean, it's the message that is the key to good gospel music. And the good news is being told in all kinds of musical styles. Styles designed to reach youthful, new audiences. I mean, there's rock, rap, rhythm and blues. They've all become part of a contemporary gospel music scene that will dazzle you with its diversity and its incredible energy.
This is the biggest lie that's ever come down the pike, that all kinds of music glorify God, no matter what they are. What is the purpose of music? Music is not evil. Music is a beautiful creation of God. But it was designed for only one purpose, and that's to bring God's people closer to Him and give glory to the Lord. Music was not designed to fill up our dead airspace or make sure we don't have a boring day. That's Satan's lie. To many young people, and even those who profess Christ today, to go without their favorite music would be a fate worse than death. Satan has pulled the wool over millions of minds, and the Dove Awards are the best example. We're going to talk about Michael W. Smith, and we're still discussing what kind of a gospel message is coming through at these live Christian rock shows. Here's Michael W. Smith in concert giving his invitation to accept Christ.
Okay. You need to know that we are here to encourage you. We can rock and roll all night long, but I tell you what, when it comes down to it, the main reason we're here is we're here to encourage you. Be strong, courageous, hang tough. I'm serious. And one more thing. You people who are straddling the fence, get on one side or the other, okay? This song is about peer pressure.
Now, all of that sounded real good. There's just one problem. There was no preaching done there about repentance, about turning away from sin, about how we need to be a new creature in Christ and convert. You see, that's what being a Christian really is. You don't want to do the same old things you did before. You're released from the bondage of those sins. You're made a new creature in Christ, as 2 Corinthians 5:17 says. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. You're not getting this message in Christian rock today. Therefore, it's not the true gospel of Jesus. It's a phony, baloney gospel based on the love of money, which is the root of all evil, 1 Timothy 6:10. While we're talking about being a new creature in Christ and forsaking the old ways, let's talk about Petra. Petra has been one of the biggest bands in Christian rock for the past 20 years. They've had a tremendously powerful influence on thousands and thousands of young people. Let's take a listen to the next two pieces of music, and you'll see where Petra's inspiration comes from. That first song was released by Kiss in 1984. The second Petra song came out in 1990. According to some Daystar Promotions material, here's what Petra keyboardist John Laurie said. Quote, "We all grew up in the rock era, so we've been heavily affected by everyone from the Beatles to Deep Purple and Led Zeppelin." No wonder the guys in Kiss don't want to get saved. The Christian rockers are coming to them for their music. And by the way, according to the Holman Study Bible, Petra was the capital of Edom, a pagan land that the Lord despised. Petra was the high place of sacrifice, where children were sacrificed to devils. We're going to take a look at some video clips from Revival in the Land by Carmen, and we'll see what kind of gospel message and what kind of Christ is being presented to millions of young fans.
Yeah, you got it going on, man. I'm talking about real. Here come the thick one. Yeah, look at him. On a cross of wood, they crucified the Lord Jesus Christ, and after he died.
So Jesus Christ is a gang member, is that right? Who gets in a rumble and ends up on the wrong side of a knife. Is that the Jesus of the Bible? No, Christian Rock and Carmen in this video have made Jesus Christ look like some foolish wimp that couldn't even defend himself and ended up dead and useless. Here's another clip from Carmen's video, Revival in the Land.
This general of evil agrees to confer with his chief demon lieutenant. This is the story of that encounter.
Do you know what this is, friends? Really? It's Christian gore. It's the power of Satan elevated far beyond anything that is true in reality. Carmen fans will yell and scream and they'll say, but you've taken all that out of context. Don't you know that that whole clip was about how the power of God and Christ is reaching out over this world and there's a mass revival going on and the throne room of hell is shaking? That's what it appears to be on the surface. But understand something. You and I as Christians can't go see the filthy, gory movies. We can't go to the splatter films. We can't see the occultic special effects. We're not supposed to, although many Christians do. My wife and I know a pastor took his youth group to go see some of this stuff because he gave in to the pressure and he didn't want to lose those kids, so he compromised and dropped his standards, and now he's their buddy and they sure do like him a lot. But where's the holiness and where's the separation? So you and I can't go see those things, but we'll take a substitute, won't we? We'll take Carmen's Christian gore, we'll take Carmen's Christian occultism, and we'll watch it all day long, we'll rent it in the Christian bookstore, and we'll talk it up to our friends. Here's another video by Carmen called Radically Saved.
You lamb of God, man. I want to talk to you now, man. I want to talk to you now. So Jesus just kind of walks over, just sort of like Messiah type walk, just sort of. Whatever. They grow up and they go their separate ways, and one day John comes back on the scene dressed in camel hair eating bugs. You know, little locusts, grasshoppers, you know, cockroaches, la cucaracha, la cucaracha.
In this video clip, whether you noticed it or not, Carmen just blasphemed the Bible. And that Tulsa, Oklahoma audience in the Brady Theater roared with laughter and approval, didn't they? This is one of the biggest, most popular videos in Christian bookstores all over the country and even the world. And yet Carmen just did a little funny routine about how John the Baptist was an idiot and a maniac in the desert who ate bugs and cockroaches, and how Jesus Christ was a fool who didn't even know why he had a ministry. That's blasphemy, friends. You see, you and I should always be ready to laugh at ourselves, but we should never laugh at the Bible. We should never laugh at our Lord Jesus. It's what Christ went through for you and me. These people are making Jesus the butt of a joke, and that's the true Christ that's being presented through Christian Rock and CCM. These people are taking the name of the Lord in vain. If you'll do a careful study on that word vain from Exodus 20, you'll find that not only is it cursing God, using his name loosely, but it's also making him common and bringing him down to the street level, into the gutter, which is just what Christian Rock has done. They've elevated Satan to a position he doesn't enjoy, and they've also pulled down Christ to our level as if he was our buddy and our friend. We're going to talk now about one of the biggest names in CCM, and there are certain people you're not supposed to talk about as if they were gods or goddesses. Well, Amy Grant is not a goddess, and we're going to match her so-called ministry against the Word of God. When Amy Grant wore a miniskirt, she went straight to number one. Is that what it takes to make it in the world today? Amy Grant's Heart in Motion tape has broken all kinds of records, and it's the first major crossover for a Christian artist. That means she's crossed over now. That means she's no longer considered to be just a Christian. Now she's made it big in the secular market too. Let's see what the lost say. The people that don't even know Jesus Christ. What do they say about Amy's new tape? This is from an interview, April 5th, 1991. On most of Heart in Motion, she ignores theology entirely in a way that convinces you she's determined to become a major secular star. Grant helped write almost every song, and thank God she's not preaching to the converted. In fact, she's not preaching at all. You see, in order to come to that kind of success in the world, you've got to drop Jesus. And that's exactly what Amy Grant has done. If you want proof of that, we're going to look at a TV clip interview with Amy after the release of her new album.
Marriage was considered, I think it's fair to say, a more wholesome, clean-cut, in the Christian music mode image, whereas now this is a sexier, more daring kind of image. And so what's going
well,
on
I guess
here?
Maybe so. I think it's all in the where you come from and just how you see it. You know, everybody sees things differently. But I really, my whole thrust with music right now is to write and perform music that's fun, that just the kind of stuff that I grew up with. I feel like there can never be enough of that. I mean, I remember the first time I heard the Beatles, "I Want to Hold Your Hand," and I just thought, yes, that's it. And we just need as much of that as we can get, just innocent, out there having a good time.
Amy just said that she really liked the Beatles, that it was a major influence on her all those years ago. Well, the Beatles were communists, they were atheists, and they hated the Lord Jesus Christ with a passion. You want proof of that? Listen to these comments by the late John Lennon, founder of the Beatles, and what he said about the Lord Jesus. John Lennon said, "Jesus was a garlic-eating, stinking, little yellow, greasy, fascist blank." That's what the Beatles thought about Jesus, but Amy loves the Beatles.
A departure for you in terms of image. This is a new Amy Grant from the Amy Grant we're accustomed to seeing, a new sexy kind of image geared more towards popular success. What's going on here? Is this why this change in image?
See, that's funny. I don't really think it's a change in image. I must have really been a piece of stale bread before.
You said that. I don't think I'd quite put it that way. But, you know, the image was considered, I think it's fair to say, a more wholesome, clean-cut, in the Christian music mode image, whereas now this is a sexier, more daring kind of image. And so what's going
well,
on
I guess
here?
Maybe so. I think it's all in the where you come from and just how you see it. You know, everybody sees things differently. And I think that sex appeal plays in there somewhere, but even that it's not the focus of what I'm doing. It really isn't. It's just trying to provide a great music backdrop for.
Amy also said that sex appeal is a good thing, especially for Christian women. It's not something to be avoided. Let's take a close look here at another one of Amy's new videos, where she and a girlfriend who's shamelessly exposing herself with her clothing immodestly are hosed down on a fire truck while men dance around them. Amy said she's just the same old girl doing what she's always done. That should tell us something, friends. The Amy Grant today is not the Amy Grant of all those years ago that sang sweet little love songs to the Lord. Amy Grant has truly crossed over. And the album that did it for her round about 1986 was Unguarded. This was the first big step toward crossover success for Amy Grant. Her husband, Gary Chapman, wrote most of the music for the Unguarded album, and he's been a major influence in her songwriting. It might surprise some people to know that Gary Chapman was under the influence of drugs when he was writing Unguarded's music. And he admits it. This is from People magazine, May 1991. Gary Chapman says, "I was into excessive use of pot and cocaine from the time I was around 20 until I was around 27. Now, Gary Chapman has kicked his drug habit today, and that's a good thing. But let's understand something. Music is spiritual. It's not neutral. We've already proved that. The Bible says in the book of Revelation that there are witchcrafts in the latter times, in the last days, the kind of witchcrafts that seduce the whole world. And the literal Greek meaning of that word in the book of Revelation is pharmakia. And that's where we get the word pharmacy or drugstore today. That means that Gary Chapman was under the influence of drugs, was involved in witchcraft because of taking drugs, and was producing music through the spirit of witchcraft, which put Amy Grant over the top during the Unguarded years. That means that that music was influenced by the spirit of Satan, which is one reason why it was so popular. Whether he knew it or not, Chapman was a channel because of his drug use. And incidentally, that same spirit is still in that music. Is there any witchcraft in Amy Grant's new videos? Oh, yes. We're going to take a look here at That's What Love Is For. There are some things we're going to go back and look at very slowly in freeze frame. Amy Grant in this video is wearing a red hooded robe. Now, who wears red hooded robes? Satanists do. And here's a clip from ex-Satan high priest Mike Warnke saying what those red robes are for.
Hood, Mike, what's this for?
This is to create for whoever's practicing a magical atmosphere.
The colors mean anything?
Yeah, the red ones would be used for some types of sexual rituals. People who are doing sexual magic, this would be used for ordinary ceremonies and also for ceremonies where you'd be throwing a curse on somebody.
Am I saying that Amy Grant is a devil worshiper? No. But somebody somewhere knows exactly what they're doing. And as we've seen throughout this video, they've marked Amy's stuff. Why? Because she's crossed over into Satan's kingdom. Where's the protection of Jesus Christ when you've left him behind in the dust in order to have the success of millions and millions of people? There's another part of this video you need to be aware of. Strange hand movements and strange body stances are throughout MTV secular videos. Those aren't dancing. Those aren't choreography. Many times those are something called witchcraft runing. Those are hand signs and signals meant to call up demons. In the world of the occult, this is well known for people that have delved into it for many years. They can call spirits without saying a word. Take a look at Amy's hand movements as she dances in this red dress. Take a look at Amy's gloves and the palms of her hands, and take a very close look at what is sewn onto her uniform on those gloves. Those are six-pointed stars. Those are called hexagrams in the world of witchcraft. That's where we get the word to hex or to place a spell. So you have red hooded robes, which are used for magic. You have witchcraft sign language to call up spirits, and you have the hexagrams on the palms of Amy's hands. Why are all these things here in someone who's supposed to be a Christian artist? So there's a lot of blackness in the things that are being produced through the Amy Grant organization today. Is that a surprise? Not really. Listen to these lyrics of one of Amy's songs. "There are two of me. One does the right thing. One cannot see. Choices I make take me right between patches of light and darkness in me." Have these people been confronted? Has anybody gone to them with these kinds of things? Has anybody ever taken the scripture to the stars of Christian rock? Yes, they have. I personally have written Carmen. I've written Stryper. I've written Petra. Stryper never gave me a reply, and neither did Carmen's organization, even though a sister in Christ in his church in Tulsa, Oklahoma, saw to it that it was put right into his hands. Michael W. Smith and Amy Grant organizations have also been confronted. Here's proof.
I guess I'm just really disappointed to see that here you were talking about a woman when she's not there to defend herself. And I really feel that if you have a problem with her and her music or anything else she does, you need to first go to her.
Ma'am, let me say this so that you understand that the comments made about Amy Grant and the article where she was bathing in the nude and the article about the coarse language and the article having to do and the involvement at a state fair under the sponsorship of an alcoholic beverage company, I did call Amy's office. So you're in judgment tonight and may not be aware of that, but I did call Amy's office because I wanted to be sure that somebody wasn't trying to write something that was scandalous.
Okay, well,
And let me finish now, ma'am. I did call there and I said to them, I said, I'm talking about this publication that has come out and is a public testimony. And I wanted to know how you people are reacting to this. Is this accurate or is it a scandal? They said it is very accurate. We are very proud of it.
Well, sure, Vic. And I'd like to address this to anybody that has questions about this issue, especially the young lady that just called. These people are not hiding what they feel. They're not denying what's been said about them. They are very, very proud of everything that's appeared in print about them. And so we're kind of putting the cart before the horse to say, shouldn't you run after them and try and get it straight with them? They don't want to get it straight. They're perfectly happy, and they've gone on record as saying so with their position about Christian rock, about how they want to live, and about what they want to do. When you've got somebody that has national prominence, like an Amy Grant or a Michael W. Smith, it's all a matter of public record, and they'd be the first to admit it. So there's absolutely nothing wrong with taking the principles of the Bible and applying them against what these people have said in print. It's all documented. It's all sourced. It's not being made up. There are two brothers here in the state of Wisconsin that I've met personally who went to Michael W. Smith and his pastor or assistant pastor in Nashville at the Belmont Assembly Church. And they confronted him in love from the scriptures, and the end result was nothing. No repentance, no change, nothing.
What are the roots of rock and roll? Where did rock start? This is a quote from a pro-Christian rock magazine called Media Update, Volume 10, Issue 6. This speaks for the whole Christian rock lie as to rock's roots. Here's what it says. There are those who claim that the volume and the beat are evil because rock music came from the jungles of Africa and the worship of demons. People who say this don't know much about music history. The foundations of rock music can be traced directly back to the beginnings of the black American church in this country. That is a lie. Rock and roll music has always been a part of every pagan culture, and what it was used for was the worship of demons. Do you want proof of that? This is a letter from a man named Jim Warkenton, and it comes through the Bill Gothard Organization in Illinois. Jim lives in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Here's what he says about rock's roots. It was in the early 1970s when my sisters arrived in Kalimantan Barat, Indonesia, where our parents are serving as missionaries with REMU International. With them, they had brought a contemporary Christian record, which was the in thing in Canada, they said. They were playing the record one evening when an older national Christian stopped by the door. To my sister's astonishment, his immediate question was, "Why are you playing witch doctor's music by which they call on Satan?" To the national, who had left the old heathen practices, which included the witch doctor, it was hard to explain why Christian young people in the churches who had sent out the missionary to teach them the way of salvation and separation from the world could even begin to listen to that kind of music. I was there when this incident happened and am writing now to verify it. The roots of rock and roll have always been squarely in Satan's camp. It's the worship of demons. What about Christian rap? Well, if Christian rock is wrong, then Christian rap is wrong too. Matthew 6, verse 7 says,
But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. So you see, a vain repetition is a mark of the heathen, those that don't believe in God and don't want anything to do with God. What is rap music anyway? It's a vain repetition. So let's get this straight. Christian rap says that we're to use vain repetitions like the heathen in order to bring people to Christ. But the Bible didn't bear that out. Here's a famous Christian rap star named Michael Peace. The source is Charisma and Christian Life, February 1990, page 42. Michael Peace says, "I know we're something, y'all, if we have Jesus. I didn't come to tell you you're a sinner. You can be a bunch of winners for Jesus." Friends, if you and I don't know we're sinners, we can never be saved. Because Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." We're going to talk about Stryper. Stryper are one of the biggest acts in Christian rock. They have held the door open for a whole slew of other bands up and coming who want to imitate their success. One of these days, Stryper will surely break up. But even if they do, it doesn't matter. The damage they've done has reached across the generations. Years ago, and for the better part of 7 years, Stryper wore uniforms of yellow and black with pyramids all over them. They even used a 777 number as their own special number. They said that that was the opposite of the mark of the beast, the 666. Well, is there any meaning to those things? Yes. In the occult, they're very important. According to this book called Treasury of Witchcraft, the yellow and black are the livery or uniform of the devil, black indicating death and yellow implying quarantine. The pyramids that Stryper have used for years in their stage shows, their video productions, on their albums, and in their uniforms are a basic sign of the New Age movement and always have been. The 777 number that Stryper says is the opposite of the number of the beast has very important significance in the occult. Here's proof. It's the title of a book by Master Satanist Aleister Crowley. A couple of years ago, Stryper brought out a new album, tape, called Against the Law. It had songs on it with titles like Rock the Hell Out of You. For the first time ever, Stryper didn't use any mention of the name of Jesus or of God in their songs. They said their goal now was top 40 radio airplay. But hey, wait a minute. I thought the goal was supposed to be to reach lost young kids with the gospel of Christ. It's funny how things change, isn't it? We're going to look at a video clip of Stryper after the Against the Law album came out. They're on Rick D's television program. Listen as Stryper mock the white robes of righteousness that the Bible says all the saints are going to be wearing when Jesus Christ comes again. Listen as Stryper admit that the group Earth, Wind, and Fire were one of their biggest influences.
Now, as a Christian rock group, did you wear these same clothes? You know, metal and chains
We used to wear yellow and black.
Robes.
And, we kind of...
White robes.
This. Big fan of Earth, Wind, and Fire because that's a shining star.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Big time.
Big time.
To take a funk song and then add... still some of the funk feel and put rock to it. That's an accomplishment right there.
They're a big influence of ours. You know, back in junior high, I remember dancing to that song.
Yeah. Earth, Wind, and Fire were one of the most occultic bands of the 1970s. Here you see them dressed as priests of Babylon with all kinds of zodiac signs above them and a big four, which according to the World Book Encyclopedia is the symbol of Jupiter, the king of gods. Even the name Earth, Wind, and Fire is important in witchcraft. There are three of the five points of the pentacle: earth, wind, fire, spirit, and water. There's a new movement sweeping the U.S. and also around the world. It's called Christian thrash. What is Christian thrash? It's punk rock and heavy metal combined, all in the name of Jesus. Here's what goes on at Christian thrash concerts. We're going to take a listen to a song by Christian thrash group Vengeance.
Now, anyone with an ounce of sense and two brain cells knocking together knows that junk isn't Christian. Do you want to know what the lyrics were? I want my head chopped off, you'll see my body rot, and then I'll reign with Christ, and then you'll fry. There's nothing Christian about Christian rap, Christian rock, or Christian thrash. It's all a deception of Satan. I want to leave you with a scripture. 1 Corinthians 10:20-22. But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils, and not to God. And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. You cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils. Do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? The answer to that is no. And my encouragement to anybody that's involved in Christian rock is, repent of that. Accept Christ as your Savior. Rededicate your life to the Lord. And have nothing to do with Christian rock or anything that even resembles it. There are three alternatives to ungodly music. One is silence. You and I don't have to listen to anything. Be still and know that I am God, is what the Bible says. The other alternative to ungodly music is the Word of God on cassette tape. Let it saturate your mind and match it with your daily reading. The third alternative to ungodly music is godly Christian music. It is out there. My encouragement to you is to seek the Lord's face with everything you've got, and He'll lead you straight to it. If you don't know Christ as Savior, you need to. Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Luke 13:5 says that you and I need to repent or we're going to perish. Romans 10:9 and 10 says we must believe deep down inside and not be ashamed to confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. Finally, Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, and that can be you right now. 1 John 1:9 says that if you and I have sinned, and if we're faithful to confess our sins, the Lord is faithful and just to cleanse us of our sins and forgive us of all unrighteousness. And that's my encouragement to you, and thank you very much for watching this video.
Bye.